colleagues who are sitting here actually from Rome. So, and what we do, they sent sort of originally was on sort of a few symmetric areas, materials, components, devices, and integration, and also economic side. Because if you don't look at economics, the politicians will not listen to you, and you will not have funding for substantial funding for doing what you want to do. So that's why we're doing that. And we also need some policy documents for the government. And for example, what I'm going to tell you next is the what our current focus. So over the last 4 years or 5 years, the world has evolved and we have changed our risk areas. So basically, we still do something what we've been doing in the past, but hot and cold energy storage. But also we're also doing some economics and policy side. So just don't want to move because the microphone is tiny. So in addition to that, we are working towards cold chain technologies. The reason for cold chain technologies is because there's a prediction in about 40 years, the energy used to produce cold will exceed that for producing heat. And the reason for that is simple. The autonomous vehicles, our electric vehicles, and so on and so forth, artificial intelligence stuff, which relies heavily on ICT technologies, which require a massive building of data centers. So if we use today's technology for whatever, the next maybe 30 years, so 40% of our power produced using today's technology will be used for cooling data centers or running data centers. So you can see the scale. And the size of data centers for that will be something like the 3-4 times of the city of metropolitan area of London. It's huge. So basically, it's not sustainable. So that's why we need to do that. So if you look at air conditioning units, we have 3 billion air conditioning units today. In 30, 40 years, we will need about 9 million, so 3 times. So that's the challenge. That's why we need the policy document for the UK government for doing that. So what else we do? We do thermochemical, electrochemical, electrical conversion storage. The reason for that is, if you look at our technology today, so each areas we are looking at one specific aspect of the whole process or the whole chain. For example, we are digging, we are mining our fuels or raw materials. We are transport. We are process that we produce energy for use. So the overall efficiency from digging to actual use is less than 10%. So I'm a bit polite to say, less than 10%, actually less than 5%. I give an example, fuel cell technologies, very popular hydrogen fuel cell technology. If you think about it, we start from electrical energy. From electrical energy to produce hydrogen using electrolysis, the efficiency is roughly 50%. Okay? So using today's technology. So if you produce hydrogen, you need to store hydrogen at a pressure. That process is necessary. I estimate about 70%, but actually lower than that, between 30 and 80%. So it's quite low. Then when you use hydrogen in fuel cells for mobility, for transportation, the efficiency is about 50%. So 50% times 50% times 70%. You can see the efficiency. So that's why we need to look at sort of the whole chain from raw material to actually use. So that's actually just the reason pattern technology, which is from the whole energy supply chain aspect. So that's one aspect. So if I look at the second aspect of what we do is smart energy system technology. So basically, we are producing smart materials for energy system, but actually the smartness of the material actually passed on to the system level of all the customers is less than 1%. So basically, they are not really used there. So you can see the resource efficiency you know, chemists, physicists, they are still talking to you with something really wonderful, you know, but actually the benefits, actually using that sort of mechanism is really, really small, tiny. Is that useful when they raise capital, for example, from, you know, venture capital, but the actual to get that benefit to the customer is very small. So that's the reason we are putting that as a new area of research. So another one is electric vehicles. So that's the cartoon I liked very much. I think, you know, if you have a cable, you know, 1,000 kilometers long, just plug in and you can you drive your car for 1,000 kilometers. No problem. Just the problem you have the wire, which is the cable, which is a so. But what I want to emphasize on the right hand side, so electric vehicles, what we do is coupling electric vehicles with batteries and thermals. So two batteries, one for electrical, one for thermal. The reason for that is if you look at today's technology using batteries, in winter, only 50% of battery power is actually used for powering the car. The rest, 50%, is for heating the car. Mm-hmm. That's the reason. And you don't ask me why. The reason is twofold. One is that the data is from our car manufacturers. We interviewed about 50 car manufacturers across the world. That's the number I got. And other reason is that you know, the air conditioning system in cars has average COP is about 1.5, and in winter is one. If I'm a bit polite, if I'm not polite, it's less than one. So it's not as good even as direct electric heating. So that's the reason. So we're also working on manufacturing technologies and also some knowledge transfer activities. So I'm going to show you something. The BCS team in Berlin, over the last 6 years, we managed to build a team with people working on different areas. And so we have included our electrochemical people. This is our future direction, because we need to integrate our thermal stores with electrochemical stores, because there's lots of thermal energy management issues in electrochemistry, chemical systems. That's the reason. And we have roughly about in chemical engineering, we have about 80 people. Across campus, it's probably 3 miles of that. That's the scale of the center in Berlin on storage research. Then I'm going to tell you something what we have achieved over the last 15 years, not only in Berlin, but also across my team over the last 15 years. So the first is about storage materials, which is relevant to the topic I'm going to talk about, is composite phase change materials. So which works by change phases between liquid and solids. But the problem with phase change materials is sort of a shape stabilization, so the change shapes, and also expansion, contraction. That's the problem. And so we managed to do that sort of from lab scale to pilot scale and to semi technical production scale. And also we are now in the industrial scale. And that's sort of a few sort of more than 10 years ago to about 3 years ago. So this is the first large scale application of the materials we have developed, which this specific case is a project in Xinjiang, Chinese Xinjiang. We used 156 tons of the composite phase change materials. But this is only for one phase change temperature, it's about 710 degrees C material. There are lots of formulations which has not been used. So we take the high voltage and turn that into heat, store that, and otherwise will be curtailed wind power. So that's been running for 3 years, and we are in the fourth year of that. So the second technology will be developed with my team and my friends, my colleagues, initially in Leeds and then in Birmingham. So it's a liquid area storage technology from more than 14 years ago. And so now it's in commercial demonstration in Manchester, which is taking the energy from the local NAND field socket and generating heat and then store the energy for liquid air. So that's built by a company called Highview. And in parallel to that, we also developed a technology called cryogenic engines, which use liquid air as a fuel for powering car engines. So that's already also been commercialized by a UK company called DM Engine Limited. So, and actually, we are now developing a large scale, which is a gigawatt scale technology for the US market, which is I'm marginally involved, but it's not my main job. That's been done, it's not me anymore, it's the company people doing that. So the another example is actually it's developed in the last 3 years. We are working with China Rail, the CRRC, on radically changing our air conditioning technologies for rail and our car systems. So without much, so we have managed to sort of reduce the weight by 20%. And also the energy efficiency increased by 18%. This is significant because if you look at the energy consumption for transportation, that's a big aspect. And so one of the, I think this is on the commercial trials scale already, so it's out of our control because it's a company is doing that. The last example is sort of it's also similar, but it's not for passenger carriages for rail transportation, but for the freight trains for the cold chain technologies. You have to control the temperature of the container so that the vegetables, perishable foods, can be preserved and medicine as well to be within a certain temperature range. And this was tried last year for 35,000 kilometers. In China, and CRRC Shijiazhuang is a commercialized technology, and hopefully you will see many of those technologies running around the ground of China across the long distance. I'm talking about 1,000 kilometers. So what I can say is that one charge will give you a week of operation. So not like our electric vehicles. One charge, probably for a few hours, you have to recharge. This is just one charge gives you about a week. So you can run from Yunnan to probably Xinjiang and so on and so forth. So that's just a brief about what we've achieved over the last 15 years. So from fundamental research to commercialization. We are not doing much commercializing ourselves, but working with partners. So that's their job, not our job. So the next is because we've been using composite phase change material for a while, and what's the fundamental aspect we've been working on, that's what we're talking about. So it's from the molecular modeling based formulation to the mass manufacturing application. So I'm going to start with sort of a diagram here, really sort of why we're doing thermal. This is the reason. 90% of current energy budget sets around heat conversion, transport, and storage, full stop. It's not something else. So that's why we're interested in that. So, I mean, and hence, thermal energy actually is at the heart of the whole energy chain, which linking the primary energy sources and secondary energy sources. Primary energy sources is the fuel, whatever you have, and light, which is the renewables. So those are all the conversion steps. So that's, but you have to go through heat in most cases. Okay, you can do PV, you can do some other things, but it's a very small portion and not economically viable at the moment. But PV is okay, but the proportion is still small. The second is okay, you could tell me, what about wind? Okay, wind, there's technology which can turn wind energy into heat directly. So we can use concentrated solar power approach to do the conversion and storage. So that's the reason we are focusing on heat as well. So just tell you sort of what happens over the last maybe 10 years, maybe more. This diagram is a bit old, that still reckons that of what's happening. So if you look at the storage area of the last 10 years, so publications, this is the web, this is the green bar. The blue bars is lithium-ion batteries mainly. And this is mainly thermal energy storage area. So you can see before 2009, they're similar. After 2009, you know, the lithium-ion battery is going very quick, so we can't catch up because our sort of electric vehicles driven activities and investment by, you know, venture capital, so on and so forth. And if you look at patterns, the same, so same trend, you know, of course, you know, actually the lithium-ion batteries patterns are a lot more than other areas. So you can see the actual two major areas of storage is one is lithium-ion batteries, another one is thermal. It's not sort of other areas. So let me tell you what's the current situation of storage installation in the world. Different people will use different diagrams. This is the most sort of objective diagram I can show you in the world. So basically, you know, the pumped hydro is coming off from the mountain and then store energy. So that's So that all have challenges. So what I'm relating here really is that is integrated, which is a problem, because this is what we have in the past. This peak, this campaign, the yesterday, this user, they are rigid connection. There's no storage, it's rigid connection. It's very easy to manage. You either stop the generation plant because electric energy produced must be consumed instantly, otherwise you can't store, or you have to waste electricity. With storage, because storage link every component, so this makes it a lot more complicated. And storage can be in the generating side, can be in the user side, can be used in the transmission side, makes it a lot more complicated. Which means there's no one single right answer for any questions involved. We have different routes and we have different complexity involved. That's the reason it's actually a challenge. So, of course, science challenges is more tricky to deal with. This is basically from material formulation to systems, so application. So this is actually a cross very large nanoscale issue. Formulating at molecular scale and application at the 10 to 3 meter scale, which is quite a big scale difference. So when you look at how to link the properties of materials to the system performance, you have to do the feedback. So it's problem can cross the depends on magnitude. So this is different for different systems, but challenges remain similar. So we are dealing with as similar challenges. How do we do that? We've been working on that for about 15 years or 20 years on that. We have not been able to resolve sort of more than two systems. And for heat storage, using the phase change materials, we have managed to have done one cycle. So from formulation to system level optimization, we have not managed to sort of refine that in many feedbacks. So that's the issue, because think about the team. We have about 88 people in my team, and worked for so many years, just for one cycle. So that's difficult. So approach we needed was